Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Rescuing the Gospel from the Cowboys, a Native American expression of the Jesus Way, by Richard Twiss. Narrated by Kaipo, Schwab. Publisher's note: in this audio edition, you will hear references to tables present in the print and ebook formats of the book. In Memoriam, Richard Leo Twiss, June 11, 1954 to February 9, 2013. Richard Leo Twiss, Tau Yate Obnajin, he stands with his people, passed from this life and into the next on February 9, 2013, in Washington, D.C., encircled by his wife Catherine and sons Andrew, Philip, Ian, and Daniel. Richard was 58. Richard was born on the Rosebud Reservation, South Dakota, among his mother Winona, Larvi, Lapointe's people, the Sikangu band of the Rosebud Lakota Sioux. Richard's father, Franklin Buster Twiss, deceased, was Oglala from the Pine Ridge Lakota Sioux Reservation, also in South Dakota. Until age 7, Richard lived in Rosebud, a town of 600 on the reservation. In 1961, Richard's mom moved the family from the reservation to Denver, then to Klamath Falls, Oregon, and eventually to Silverton, Oregon, where Richard attended the 3rd through 12th grades. Richard's mom ensured they made regular summer visits back home in order to stay connected with family and culture. After graduating from high school in 1972, Richard moved back to Rosebud to attend Sinte Gleska, Spotted Tail College. It was here that he became involved in the American Indian Movement, AIM. During this tumultuous time, Richard strengthened his connection with relatives and deepened his appreciation for Lakota culture. Richard wandered for a while, ending up on the island of Maui in Hawaii, where late one night, alone on a deserted beach, Creator responded to Richard's desperate prayer, making himself known to him. From that night in 1974 until his passing, Richard was on a spiritual journey to live a meaningful life as a Lakota follower of the Jesus Way. Richard met and fell in love with Catherine Crocius of Vancouver, Washington, and married her in 1976. Richard's proudest legacy is his four boys, Andrew, Diana, Philip, Ian, Tony, and Daniel, and his grandsons, Ezra, Leo, and Jude. In February 1997, Richard and Catherine founded the nonprofit ministry of Wichoni International. Through Wichoni, Richard and Catherine touched the lives of many thousands of people. Richard also co-founded NAIITS, North American Institute for Indigenous Theological Studies. He was chairman of the board for My People International, a member of the CCDA, Christian Community Development Association, and co-founder of Evangelicals for Justice. In 2011, Richard earned his doctorate in missiology from Asbury Theological Seminary. Until his passing, Richard continued his teaching career through the NAIITS program, Portland State University, and other institutions of higher education. Richard authored a number of books, pamphlets, and articles over the years. His first book, One Church, Many Tribes, reached many people with the message of an inculturated faith in Jesus. Richard's mother, Winona Lapointe, sisters Elaine and Laurie Lapointe, nieces Stacy, Mark, Melissa, Tony, Jana, and their children remain to continue his memory. His brother, Tom, passed before Richard in 2010. Composed by Terry LeBlanc, with assistance from Richard's family. Foreword. Each of us met Richard Twiss at different times, yet each of us met when our own journeys and Richard's needed additional lift to go forward on our common trail. Whether our first meeting was at a conference, through an introduction, while studying together, or just hanging out and taking a retrospective look at our Creator's thoughts, all of us became fast friends with Richard. We all reflect very similarly on the fact that Richard had the astounding ability to absorb what he read or heard from others, transforming and then seamlessly integrating it into his own thinking. While each of us does somewhat the same thing, as a function of our Indigenous communal approach to knowledge, Richard was a master. It was in Spokane, Washington, in 1995, where Richard hit his stride. He had convened a Christ, Culture, and the Kingdom seminar for pastors to present our new ideas about culture and faith. When the conference ended and all the attendees had departed, we turned to one another, amazed that non-Indigenous pastors were keenly interested in what we had to say. It was the start of a new era for Indigenous followers of the Jesus Way. Our individual and collective encounters forged links of deep and unbreakable friendship. Our camaraderie was truly symbiotic, an idea from one transformed by the other, complete with escalating humor. Our journey together depended so much on humor that after a number of years of tag team conferences, Richard's mom referred to us as a stand-up comedy team. There was never any doubt that Terry was the straight man. When Richard was provided the opportunity for doctoral studies at Asbury Theological Seminary, he was more than a bit reluctant to attempt such a lofty goal. Moreover, we were all frustrated that advanced degrees seemed necessary to further our efforts to bring an Indigenous voice to the wider public. In Richard's first week of school, we had no fewer than 7 serious discussions about him quitting the program. Yet, in the end, the experience brought us closer together. The Indigenous message we brought to class discussions became such a dominant, decolonizing voice that we were concerned about being too great an influence. But the professors encouraged us, pointing out how we were empowering international students to speak up. Following a welcome event that we hosted, where Richard spoke words of affirmation for those in attendance, 70 students from around the world expressed that for the first time, they felt welcome to this country. Passionate argument often highlighted our close friendship, yet while so engaged, we never expressed animosity or ill will, only deep commitment to one another. Just before his passing, for example, an argument raged over Richard's attempt to nuance the definition of syncretism in this, his last book. He used the descriptor counteractive to modify the word syncretism, attempting a new definition with this two-word phrase, counteractive syncretism. We told him it was needless confusion. This hybrid phrase just didn't correspond to the simple definition of syncretism. A lot of food for thought like this came to him in deep discussions over many lattes. That he took our viewpoint seriously was always evident because later on, we would hear people say, "Richard says," and in their words, we would hear our own words being repeated, the ones we had previously discussed, even argued over. In our Indigenous communal way, he took our thoughts, those that were different from his, and made them his own. Two different things, his thoughts and our thoughts, became one new thing, his new thought. Now that is the definition of syncretism. His nuancing of the word syncretism is still not what we might agree with, but we think he would just laugh at this non-endorsement endorsement of one of our best and deepest friends. Richard was enigmatic. On the one hand, as he made clear in the closing years of his life, he was a common man. Yet undoubtedly, in many ways, he was not. He became, for many in the wider Indigenous community, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, inviting believers to make straight paths for people to find Jesus. Denominational and doctrinal competition that encroached on his early experience of faith set Richard up to return to the simple message of Jesus, a highly energized story of a Jesus stripped of colonial baggage. And Richard used his unique style and affable sense of humor to communicate this like no one else ever could. Richard was a foil to anyone who encumbered the message of Jesus with culturally bound prejudice. He presented a simple path to faith, inviting people to be all they could be through a renewed relationship with Creator's Son. He welcomed everyone to be a part of what Creator was doing among us, making everyone feel special in the process. We hope you will sense his generous spirit as he welcomes you to broaden your horizons, to come to understand a world where, in Richard's words, the gospel is being rescued from the Cowboys. Terry LeBlanc, Gitpu, Mi'kmaq Acadian, Listigush, First Nation, Campbellton. Founding Chair, Director, NAIITS, an Indigenous Learning Community, Executive Director, Indigenous Pathways. Randy S. Woodley, Ph.D., Kitwa Descendant, Distinguished Professor of Faith and Culture, George Fox Seminary. Author of Shalom and the Community of Creation, An Indigenous Vision, Eerdmans, and Living in Color, Embracing God's Passion for Ethnic Diversity, InterVarsity Press. Adrian Jacobs, Ganasano, Turtle Clan, Cayuga Nation, Six Nations, Haudenosaunee Confederacy, Keeper of the Circle Principle, Sandy Salto Spiritual Center. Ray Aldred, Neihaw, Cree, Treaty 8, Assistant Professor of Theology, Ambrose University and Seminary, Chair, NAIITS, an Indigenous Learning Community. You just ghosted. You didn't say goodbye, you just ghosted. We turned around and you just weren't there. 1,000 miles away from home you fell. You left for heaven and plunged us all in hell. You didn't give us a hug, you just ghosted. In the middle of winter, the cold breeze blew. Stranded and poor, we had no way to get to you. 1 month later, we finally showed, softened and blue. You left without a word, you just ghosted. Words only partially typed and a messy pile. Now we're sweeping things up and tying a bow, finishing your story with, "This is what we know." You left without a signature, you just ghosted. Outstanding heart accounts that'll never be paid. But we're carrying on doing the best we surmise, dealing with your quick exit and total surprise. Adrian Jacobs. Preface. How Kola. Hello, friend. This manuscript, Rescuing the Gospel from the Cowboys, is based on my reflections, experiences, and intense research over the past 24 years. It is the story of many of us Native and Indigenous leaders who have been finding our way out of neo-colonialism into a new liberty as we've walked this Jesus road together since the late 1980s. This book began as a doctoral dissertation to research whether or not there is, or has been, an Indigenous contextualized expression of the Christian faith among the tribes of the United States and, to a lesser degree, Canada. The purpose of my research was to identify in what ways Native leaders were reframing the gospel narrative as part of a larger narrative of post-colonial decolonization in their own unique cultural contexts. The specific focus will be on the years 1989 to 2009. As I think about it these days, contextualization is not a principle, formula, or evangelistic strategy. Contextualization is a relational process of theological and cultural reflection within a community, seeking to incorporate traditional symbols, music, dance, ceremony, and ritual to make faith in Jesus a truly local expression. There is an honest recognition of the guidance of Creator's Spirit behind the widening critique and correction to the hegemonic assumptions of modernity and colonization, decolonization. Critical thinking and re-traditionalization are key to the good contextualization efforts arising among Indigenous communities. In the radically changing ethnic demographics of American culture and the global community, followers of Jesus are presented with great opportunities and challenges for good. We must genuinely appreciate all cultures as being capable of reflecting biblical faith. We must move away from American Christian mythology, which undergirds colonization and its resulting paternalism in Indigenous communities. We must embrace new theological perspectives emerging from Native leaders as being equal. These perspectives provide new pathways for the contextualization process. These pathways identify Indigenous cultural values, spirituality, and ceremony as central to the new approaches to discipleship and leadership development, which occur within the community. No longer are such new approaches brought in by the cultural outsider. 1. The Creator's presence among Native people. There is only one Creator of heaven and earth. There are not many creators, just one. All of human and non-human creation comes out of this one creator. There is not a creator who created Africa and Africans, or Asia and Asians, or Europe and Europeans, and so forth. Who can create something from nothing or bring into existence something that was previously non-existent? It is only this one creator, and there is none like him, her. That being said, this one creator self-reveals in and through a myriad of cultural realities in human and non-human persons throughout Unkimaka, our Mother Earth. There are world religions that present names for this one creator. These religions provide creation stories and explanations for heaven, earth, and humans, and supply wisdom and doctrines to help humanity resolve its existential dilemma. There are world religions that have a sacred text to reference their beliefs, and there are thousands of folk religions with oral traditions that do the same through story. Yet, there is still just one creator. For us First Nations people, following Creator Jesus within our indigenous cultural ways without submitting to the hegemonic cultural assumptions of today's conservative evangelicals is tough. I am reminded weekly of these neo-colonial and ignorant assumptions as they show up on the radar of my life. The following email conversation I had in 2012 typifies these pings. A group of my First Nations friends and I were looking for a facility to host a weekend planning retreat. We looked at a few of them and decided on one I knew about from past experience. The negotiations to book the facility took an unexpected but not totally surprising turn as the registration person reacted to the heathen Indians once again. "Hello, Mr. Twiss. Whenever we have a new group register with our facility, we take the time and effort to research their beliefs and methods, etc. I have been doing that with your group, and we must cancel your retreat with us. In your effort to restore culture, you are taking the indigenous people back into paganism, shamanism, false gods, and the occult. You are leading them away from the gospel message of the Bible. We pray you will rethink what you are doing to the very people you love so much. I will return your deposit. Thank you. Jane Doe." Greetings, Jane Doe. Thank you for your response. I have many years of involvement and friendship with people in your center. I look forward to continuing this conversation and still keeping our reservation to host our retreat there. While a few may have some narrow and misinformed ideas about our faith in Jesus and the scriptures, please be assured, our group is as remarkable a group of Christ followers as you will meet. Please feel free to give me a call on my cell phone today. Thank you, Richard. Hello, Richard. Thank you so much for your email. I am aware of your history. We do not doubt your sincere heart and desires, but some of the teachings of your group and/or its speakers seem to be steering people away from the solid gospel and taking people toward other gods. It may be subtle, and it may not be your intent, but if one person leaves our facility compromised in their Christian walk, then we have failed in our mission. It is a hard thing we have to do, but the Lord has asked us to take a very strong stand, and we can do nothing less. I have returned the deposit and have still canceled the retreat. We pray the Lord will continue to guide you carefully in your efforts. Jane Doe. Greetings, Jane. Thanks for your response, which honestly surprises me. It is certainly not the spirit that I have felt from the organization's beginning, as its founders poured their lives into creating a space for people to wrestle with the deep issues of life and spiritual growth. So many of us were in our early 20s when we first journeyed there, struggling to make sense of this new faith and life we found in Jesus. The accusations you make against us, biblical compromise, falsehood heresy, steering people away from the gospel into idolatry, rejecting Christ, clothed in the notion of protecting the true gospel from native cultural ways of our native Christian community, are plainly offensive, theologically arrogant, and judgmental at best, perhaps culturally racist at worst. Your language of "the Lord has asked us to take a very strong stand" against people like us and the way we express our faith in Jesus biblically, culturally, and theologically reveals the kind of cultural oppression our people face from an idealized and racialized view of Scripture. If the goal is to turn your center into a bastion of biblical protectionism, theological control and cultural judgmentalism. Your words well reflect that direction. Peace and grace, Richard. Richard, the answer is still no. I hear what you are saying, but we still cannot support what your group and the Indigenous people movement are teaching. No retreat at our facility. Jane Doe. While this person may represent a more extreme point of view, it nonetheless is what the majority of Euro-American evangelicals believe about our native cultural and ceremonial ways. Ignorance, suspicion, and fear of native ways run deep in the soul of the American church. I will show later how this has been and remains the American church's attitude toward our native ways for centuries now. The tragedy is that it is not just we who suffer. Because we suffer so deeply, the entire church and nation does too. However, suspicion and fear run both ways. Indigenous people have a lot to fear about the white man's religion. Conquest, racism, hatred, prejudice, exclusion, forced assimilation, and ongoing institutional injustices are just a few of the fears that come to mind. Even when we get it right, we get it wrong. Spokane, Gary. When my wife and I lived on the Coeur d'Alene Reservation in northern Idaho in 1996, I was introduced to a life-changing story about a remarkable Native leader named Chief Spokane Gary. He is one of my heroes of faith and culture. Creator used Chief Gary, 1811 to 1892, as a messenger who had a profound spiritual impact by spreading the gospel, along with his friend and co-worker Kootenai Pelly, among his people and numerous other tribes in Washington, Idaho, Oregon, and southward. I have been to the cemetery in Spokane, Washington, where Chief Gary was buried. It was an honor and a privilege to be standing there, and I was deeply touched. He was a tribal leader, husband, father, and advocate for justice and Christian values. While his efforts appeared to have no lasting impact and did not bring the white settlers to an understanding of justice, nevertheless, throughout it all, he remained true to his faith in Jesus. He died rejected and impoverished. While we were living on the reservation, we did not know of one Native man who regularly attended any of the 6 Protestant evangelical churches, despite Gary's life work. Barely half a dozen women attended. This was true as well for the neighboring Nez Perce and Kalispell reservations. This fact stood in stark contrast to the amazing spiritual movement inspired by Chief Gary in this region that occurred prior to an established colonial presence. There were other instances of divine intervention in preparing the way of the Lord, Isaiah chapter 40, verse 3, for mission work among the tribes of this area, including prophecies among the Middle Spokane and Kalispell tribes. Yuri Rashen, Circling Raven, was a shaman from the Middle Spokane tribe in the late 1700s. He had a personal crisis of faith in Creator after his son's untimely death, so he went to Mount Spokane for a time of fasting and prayer. During this worship time, he received a vision from Creator, whom they called Quilent Satmen, He Made Us. In the vision, Yuri Rachen saw white men dressed strangely, carrying bundles of leaves fastened together. He was told that the people were to learn from the teachings inscribed on the leaves. Shining Shirt. A similar vision, in about the same time period, was given to Shining Shirt, said to be both a chief and a shaman of the Kalispell tribe. Ethnologist Harry Holbert Turney High writes that Shining Shirt was granted a vision in which he was told that there is a creator, and that fair-skinned men in black robes would come and teach them how to live in a new way, according to a moral law. During the vision, Shining Shirt was given a metal object engraved with a cross. White men were unknown to these tribal people at that time. Creator had been at work preparing the native people for the arrival of the gospel of Jesus. The Christian revival among those tribes, evangelized by Spokane Gary and Kootenai Pelly, was noted by white settlers and explorers. For example, Washington Irving, in The Adventures of Captain Bonneville, further documents the spread of Christianity throughout the tribes of that region. During the winter of 1832, Bonneville camped with the Nez Perce on the Upper Salmon River in Oregon and observed. Simply to call these people religious would convey but a faint idea of the deep hue of piety and devotion which pervades their whole conduct. Their honesty is immaculate, and their purity of purpose and their observance of the rites of their religion are most uniform and remarkable. They are certainly more like a nation of saints than a horde of savages. I think the purity and genuine faith mentioned by Bonneville and others was a result of a faith birthed from the witness of Jesus following indigenous people to their own tribes. They spoke the contextual gospel from their hearts among their people. This was not simply the white man's gospel. During the time frame of 1835 to 1850, European American missionaries arrived in Washington and Oregon. They communicated the gospel from their own cultural viewpoints. The truth is that the gospel of Christ already had a foothold among the tribes of these areas. With the arrival of the white missionaries and their brand of Christianity, the story takes a predictable and unfortunate turn. Just as Catholic missionaries insisted on Roman control over earlier Celtic Christian areas, so these Anglo missionaries insisted on Euro-American, Western-style Christian worship as well as doctrine. What is worse, their paternalism, ethnocentrism, colonial collusion, and modernism soon civilized this indigenous movement of the gospel story and thus blinded these Christians to the already existing work of Creator among the native nations of the land. Today, throughout the entire region, except for the history books, there is but a remnant of that remarkable outpouring of Creator's story of grace, spirituality, and community renewal. Unfortunately, this negative legacy of Christian mission among the Coeur d'Alene, Spokane, Nez Perce, and other tribes is not exceptional. After four centuries, First Nations peoples' cultural expressions are still marginalized or oppressed across North America. Native leadership in the wider church is absent in the evangelical mainstream. These early missionaries, people of their times, found little reason to regard Native believers as co-equals because they perceived their own cultural ways as superior. Thus, the majority of these missionaries denounced and demonized Native cultural ways, part and parcel, as pagan, idolatrous, evil, and sinful. As a result, an authentic Native American cultural or indigenous expression of following Jesus was never allowed to develop. The very idea being rejected as syncretistic and incongruous with biblical faith. This kind of colonial missionary mindset is sadly not a thing of the past, but is still the prevailing perspective in both Native and non-Native Christian leaders, among those working in our tribal communities today. Instead of embracing Jesus as the Creator, the majority of Native Americans blame American Christianity and the Church for the loss of their own culture and identity. Is it any wonder that the vast majority of Native people today reject Christianity as the white man's religion? The headline of a 2007 article from the CBC News Network in Canada read, "Winnipeg Church Nixes Native Dancing at Habitat for Humanity Event." The article went on to say, "A Winnipeg church prevented Aboriginal dancers from performing at a Habitat for Humanity event this week, saying the performance was not an expression of Christian faith. Native spiritual dancing has its roots in a different spiritual belief system that is incongruent with traditional Christian worship," Pastor Mark Hughes. This pastor and his church staff, though professing a vision for creating a multi-ethnic congregation, are not exceptional in their ethnocentric views and attitudes toward First Nations people and their cultural expressions. This church averages 2,500 people in Sunday attendance, is one of the largest in Canada, and is considered a leading Christian voice in the province and city. Because of colonial missionaries' attitudes of cultural superiority, a Native American cultural expression of following Jesus didn't develop at the time. Another powerful factor contributing to the cultural oppression brought with the gospel was that Native people were, many times, first introduced to Jesus as part of American territorialism, treaty enforcement, educational programs, economic hegemony, and social disintegration through assimilation. For a period of time beginning in 1869, Indian agencies were assigned to religious societies. Those assigned were duly subordinate and responsible in these official capacities as Indian agents to the United States Department of the Interior via their denominational structures. The federal government, along with denominational and missionary groups, believed this plan might improve the ability of government policies to stimulate the slow growth of the savage beasts, leading to the moral and religious advancement of the Indians. It was hoped that this collaboration between Christianity and government agencies would work to assume charge of the intellectual and moral education of the Indians within the reach of their influence. The intention was to improve the well-being of the tribal people assigned to the care of these various church missionary societies. Boarding schools. Perhaps the most devastating blow to the lives of Native Americans was the forced removal of thousands of their children from their homes, the goal being assimilation into American or Canadian society. My grandparents, parents, aunties, uncles, and numerous cousins were all required and or forced to attend either a Bureau of Indian Affairs, BIA, or Catholic-run boarding school on the Pine Ridge or Rosebud Lakota Sioux reservations. I have heard heartbreaking stories of many of their traumatic experiences. As children, my relatives endured such cruelties as being forced to work in the fields, dairy, bakery, and shops as free laborers, eating onion sandwiches while watching the priests and nuns dine lavishly by comparison, and being severely punished for speaking so much as one word in their own language. It was not unusual for children to suffer nervous breakdowns as a result of various abuses. While my mother and her siblings grew up speaking Lakota in their home, they chose not to teach us, their children, in order to protect us from the kind of racism and prejudice they had experienced. In part, too, they wanted us to be successful in the white man's world, and speaking Lakota was a hindrance to that. The boarding school experience was a major factor in their decision. The effects of the boarding school era have steadily flowed down through the generations to my relatives and to a lesser degree to me, and now my wife and sons. We see the results of this policy on the Rosebud Reservation today. An article in the New York Times titled "Indian Reservation Reeling in Wave of Youth Suicides and Attempts" tells the story of the traumatic results of these boarding schools. The young people attempting and/or committing suicide are the children and grandchildren of those forced to attend the boarding schools on the Rosebud Reservation. David Wallace Adams, in his book Education for Extinction, American Indians and the Boarding School Experience, 1875 to 1928, goes into great detail about the history of the boarding school era. What happened to the good news? My 20 years of observation and participation in mission activities among First Nations people has made it evident that rather than good news, the good news story remains highly ineffective among Native people. And for many, it means bad news. After hundreds of years of missionary efforts, an extremely low number of Native people are actively engaged in a life of faith in Jesus and participation in some Christian tradition. This is largely reflective of Euro-American colonial cultural forms, expressions, and worldview values. The majority of Native evangelical church leaders and members today have little understanding or appreciation of the meaning and value of critical contextualization, at least in a ceremonial or religious setting. Little attempt has been made toward the establishment of a truly Indigenous church movement that occurs within the socio-cultural, ceremonial, and religious lifeways of the community. While I am only briefly mentioning some points of historical oppression and trauma, there are volumes of texts that describe in great detail how a Eurocentric and modern worldview of early missionaries and church workers engendered a neo-colonial hegemony in American missionary efforts toward the indigenous tribes. These modernist assumptions resulted in the church's inability to represent Jesus Christ appropriately to the host people of the land. Thus came the failure to form a biblical indigenous faith among the tribes of North America. This hegemony has not dissolved or disappeared over time, but instead continues as a major problem plaguing the work of the church among First Nations people. However, some Native ministry leaders have begun to address this problem with vigor, wisdom, and courage, and that is the point of this book. I have observed that Indigenous believers are increasingly disenchanted, disillusioned, and dissatisfied with their traditional, evangelical, mostly white church experience. This has served as the impetus for a new decolonizing contextualization movement of the gospel. This movement had multiple creative centers, each somewhat independent of each other, and spread from those centers beginning in the late 1980s and on into this century. The writings from African, South American, and Asian theologians, as well as conversations with indigenous leaders around the world, inspired a new generation of indigenous leaders within the wider Christian community to begin exploring other possibilities, i.e., innovations. As they freed themselves from colonial Christianity and began a process of personal internal decolonization, they sought to contextualize the gospel in their various cultural contexts. In the past 20 years, this dissatisfaction has spread all across North America as believers embrace a new and holistic view of their relationship with Jesus and their religious practice within their cultural ways. So, is there a problem? For over 20 years, I've been a part of the growing international phenomenon of emerging indigenous decolonizing contextualization initiatives. These initiatives are contextualizing the gospel and engaging in revitalization efforts in response to the prolonged paternalism and marginalization of Native peoples. Various First Nations-led decolonizing efforts are proactively challenging and offering alternative narratives to the cultural hegemony of previous decades of Native missions. The paradigms of mission and ecclesiology that are surfacing are biblically informed alternatives to the current neo-colonial models and practices of denominations, mission agencies, and some Native Christian organizations. I have used Everett Rogers's Diffusion of Innovations in my research. I have identified the innovators, early adopters, and opinion leaders, and traced various networks and communication channels. Through interviews with the key leaders, I discovered the foundational ideologies and theologies that have inspired the various Native American indigenous contextualization initiatives within the period from 1989 to 2009. Obviously, these initiatives did not occur in a vacuum. The work and writings of others inspired the efforts of these innovators prior to 1989. And I will reference a few of them, but limit my study to the past 20 years. I gathered evidence illustrating how the prevailing attitude of existing Native church leaders and mission agencies toward these emerging contextualization efforts, which had been primarily negative, has changed over the past 20 years. It is my great hope that this book will enhance the existing body of literature on First Nations decolonizing contextual efforts in North America. Because this wave of contextualization is so new, there is very little literature available. There have been many books written by Native thinkers and theologians on the negative impact of missionary efforts among Native people. While offering a helpful critique, they offer little help in creating a redemptive way forward. I want to magnify the awareness and critical importance of innovative missiological paradigms emerging from the Native Christian community as viable biblical alternatives to existing models. A few Native leaders, representative of a conservative evangelical theological perspective, have written articles and materials that are highly critical of contextualization efforts. Other Anglo writers have been very fundamentalist or modernist in their criticisms of the movement. This book, as a broad analysis of these decolonizing initiatives, represents the significant possibility of restructuring missionary approaches and introducing new models for the encouragement of community development among our North American tribal people. This is not exclusively true for Native peoples. Our society as a whole is becoming more diverse culturally and in choice of religious faith. New mission and community development paradigms will be required for those cultures as well. I have read volumes about the early accounts of missionary activities in the United States, primarily in the Protestant community, but with some reference to the work of Roman Catholics, in order to discover the primary influences that shaped Christian missions to Native Americans. I explored some American denominational missions history literature, including material on First Nations people, to provide a more comprehensive understanding of the context in which these missionary activities occurred. I focused on the people whose stories both informed and shaped my understanding of the ways in which Christian missions have affected them. I reviewed various Euro-American philosophical, ideological, and sociopolitical influences that provided perspectives to make sense of America's role in the larger Western history of colonization. Particular attention is paid to America's self-identification as a Christian nation and its policies of territorial expansion and dealing with the Indian problem. While this book is focused on North America, our colonial missions history is fundamentally similar to that of all indigenous communities around the world where European colonization occurred. In my travels, I have talked at length with indigenous friends in New Zealand, Australia, Peru, Argentina, South Africa, Samoa, Mexico, Hawaii, Rwanda, Micronesia, Mongolia, Korea, and other countries. In reality, the story of Native Americans is true of all indigenous peoples' stories. Syncretism and Westernism, all mixed up. Syncretism. What is syncretism? Basically, it is the idea of mixing, combining, or blending. In the ancient world, it was the military alliance of Cretan cities in Greece that combined their armies to fight the bad guys. It is related to synergy, which is a mutually advantageous combination of distinct leaders, organizations, ideas, elements, plans, and designs working in unity. Synchronized swimmers coordinate their movements in the pool to swim as one unit. Relative to this book, syncretism is a theological term that carries the idea of mixing religious beliefs together. For some, this is a matter of critical concern because these are not just any beliefs, but what are perceived as incompatible or opposing beliefs, not just surface or behavioral beliefs, but essential worldview perspectives. Over the past 2 to 3 decades in North America, syncretism has become a topic of intense disagreement among those involved in Native American ministry. When it comes to Western systematic theology, syncretism is not seen as positive, but rather as antithetical to sound doctrine. These perceptions of syncretism are particularly strident in Indian country when it comes to the intersection of faith and culture. I acknowledge there are situations where mixing can blur or distort one's vision of Christ, which I think is the essential problem. We know that Christ is not distorted, but people's perceptions certainly can be. Now we see things imperfectly, like puzzling reflections in a mirror, but then we will see everything with perfect clarity. All that I know now is partial and incomplete, but then I will know everything completely, just as God now knows me completely. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 12. If we can only, at best, see puzzling reflections, then perhaps we can never totally escape distortion. I am suggesting, in light of the arguable definitions of what is and what isn't syncretism, that mixing is a normative process of positive change and transformation, and not always so clear. Without attempting to present a succinct definition of syncretism, I invite you to join me and briefly wrestle with the evolution and fluidity of meanings, applications, and language. This means considering the sources or locations from which authoritative definitions originate, As Indigenous scholars, we acknowledge the need to speak to people in their own cultural languages, but there still exists the tension of remaining true to Creator's unique story of Jesus and Great Spirit's work among us while doing that. While theologians and church leaders attempt to define syncretism with relative objectivity, I don't see this being possible because the conversation is situated within, thus prejudiced by, Western reductionist categories. Native North American ministry leaders have never seriously studied its meaning outside these Western categories, and are thus predisposed to consider syncretism to be synonymous with biblical heresy. Ineffective ministry strategies continue unopposed when syncretism is confused with critical contextualization. My friend Harold Rosher, Cree, invites us to widen this discourse to include how we as Indians thought about syncretism. What was our word for that idea? He says, I suggest we use our indigenous eyes to look at the concept of syncretism not only as comparison, but to show the broader world we struggled with these issues before Christian missionaries showed up. He explains it this way. For example, let's say you were a spiritual leader from the Pine Ridge Sioux Reservation in South Dakota, and you moved into our territory here in northern Alberta, Canada, Cree country. After arriving, you began sharing your Lakota teachings among the Cree. After a while, you might mix in some Cree teachings to make it more palatable for us Crees. Our Cree elders are not opposed in principle to your being a cultural teacher. However, as a Lakota elder, you must follow our protocols for teaching. In the old days, you as a Lakota elder would sit with four different Cree elders and discuss your teachings, and these four elders would eventually get together to discuss, discern your teachings. If they felt your teachings were trustworthy, you would be given permission, even the blessing, to conduct your Lakota ceremonies in Cree country. I believe each tribe had its way of dealing with false teachings and the blending of teachings. It is because of these cultural safeguards that teachings in our original languages stayed purer. Translation into English has been difficult for tribal rituals and ceremonies to remain as exact to the traditional teachings. So, is translation another component to syncretism? As followers of Christ, we share a common belief in a ghost. Jesus said he had to leave this world so that the Helper would come in his place. Our spirit guide, our Helper, is a ghost. Fundamental to my discourse about syncretism is a great confidence in the presence, power, and persuasion of the Holy Spirit to help keep us from going off the deep end on this journey of personal and spiritual transformation when it comes to cultural appropriation in light of biblical revelation. Globally, contemporary definitions and concerns about syncretism must be rescued from the Cowboys or Western cultural captivity. While I feel compelled to use existing terminology on the topic, we desperately need to relocate the discourse about syncretism from its Western epistemological hegemony to an indigenous worldview framework. For many evangelicals, this hegemony is understood as biblically rooted in the concern for converting the lost. Thus, syncretism is threatening because it encroaches on the gospel message as the saving message by differentiating good from evil, sacred from profane, heaven from hell, and in our instance, native from non-native. As a beginning point for this rescue operation, while I acknowledge the word syncretism cannot be rehabilitated because of its theologically political nature, I do hope to dull its edge. To some degree, at least, I hope to reduce its culturally demonizing power in our indigenous communities by widening the context of the conversation. I am proposing, based on biblical research by reputable scholars, that a transitional process of syncretism is a normal part of our spiritual growth. Yes, normal. It might even be thought of as transitional syncretism, or a syncretistic process of transformation. People move in and out of syncretism as they embrace, reject, modify, learn and grow toward spiritual maturity as socio-cultural persons following Jesus. Syncretism is not the undisputed end of the process, although it might end up that way. Contemporary evangelical thought has been inclined to see syncretism in a dualistic interpretive context, as a final and unchangeable state of being. It is seen as the consequence of combining good and evil, right and wrong, correct and false, biblical and heretical, godly and demonic, enlightened and deceived beliefs or practices resulting in falsehood, heresy, or ultimate deception. This cultural deception is identified by contrasting it to the theological standards for the true faith, which is firmly embedded in a Western polemic. Peter van der Veer suggests that the term syncretism refers to a politics of difference and identity, and that as such, the notion of power is crucial in its understanding. At stake is the power to identify true religion and to authorize some practices as truthful and others as false. Syncretism came to be used by defenders of the true faith as a protection against illicit contamination, a sign of religious decadence, betrayal of principles, or the corruption of the truth. What it attempted to do was to establish itself as the single source of authentication. A group of Native evangelical leaders, Chief, Christian Hope Indian Eskimo Fellowship, offers this definition of culture and syncretism. By Native culture, we mean the dynamic learned life ways, beliefs, and values of our people as revealed in our languages, customs, relationships, arts, and rituals. In Native culture, religion permeates all aspects of life and is often identified as being the culture, even though it is only an aspect of it. By syncretism, we refer specifically to the subtle attempt to integrate biblical truth and faith in Christ with non-biblical Native religious beliefs, practices, and forms. The result is an adulteration of biblical truth and the birth of another gospel. Galatians chapter 1, verses 6 through 9. In 2000, the Native American District of the Christian and Missionary Alliance, C&MA Church, produced a position paper titled Boundary Lines. In the preamble, they write their purpose: to assist pastors and lay people to protect them from unbiblical teaching and to promote the proper use of culture in the Native American evangelical Christian context. Over the years, there seems to have been a consensus among the evangelical denominations, mission organizations, and independent Native Christian churches that true believers should break completely with all animistic practices. Recently, there has been introduced in the Native evangelical church community the concept that drums, rattles, and other sacred paraphernalia formerly used in animistic worship can be redeemed for use in Christian worship. This position does not enjoy consensus among Native evangelical church leaders. The paper addresses the fundamental issues relating to the concept of redeeming, transforming, animistic objects for Christian worship. Legitimate definitions of the terms culture, worldview, syncretism, cultural form and meaning, sacred objects, and critical contextualization as they relate to this study have been provided. Both of these Native-produced documents attempt to establish their views as the standards for biblical authenticity, or the official Native positions. They are quoted as authoritative sources of biblical scholarship within our wider Native evangelical community. Their use of the phrases adulteration of biblical truth, birth of another gospel, true believers, unbiblical teaching, proper use of culture, and legitimate definitions of terms implies control. It is again what van der Veer describes as the power to identify true religion and to authorize some practices as truthful and others as false, as the single source of authentication. It is not good hermeneutics. It would appear that theology needs not only to be rescued from the cowboys and the crown, but perhaps the Indians, indigenous leaders, too. Rather than creating categories of true and false, I think we would be better served if we considered syncretism to be the exploration of the synthesis of faith, belief, and practice in a dynamic process of blending, adding, subtracting, changing, testing, and working things out. This process does not take anything away from the authority of Scripture or orthodoxy. The critical dynamic for this process of producing loving and mature followers of Jesus, however, is that it is not an individualistic venture. It is thoroughly rooted in a community of fellow seekers. This is where safety and balance are found. That being said, however, conversations between the conservative and less conservative native leadership have not occurred with any regularity, and relationships remain estranged. Because we are frail human beings, the dynamics of personal spiritual growth over time cannot be easily, cleanly identified and quantified or categorized for accuracy. Jesus told his early disciples that after new seeds were planted and weeds began to grow up alongside them, they couldn't distinguish the difference between the weeds and the wheat growing in the field. So he advised them not to pull up the weeds, because they'd be pulling up the wheat too. Matthew chapter 13, verses 24 through 30. Jesus said, "Yes, just as you can identify a tree by its fruit, so you can identify people by their actions." Matthew chapter 7, verse 20. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Galatians chapter 5, verse 22. While these fruits, qualities, values, or characteristics are universally true for all people, how do they find expression uniquely in each local culture? Charles Craft notes the question faced by Christian witnesses is, however, whether any given undesirable state is but a step in a continuing process, or whether the changes have virtually come to an end and the people are settled in their present beliefs and behavior. Is someone simply passing through on his or her journey, or have they decided to settle in and dwell there? Is settling for an hour too long? How about a week, month, year, or decade? What is actually at stake with syncretism? Salvation? Eternal acceptance in heaven or rejection in hell? Judgment? Or how about power, control, position, status, and authority? Syncretism implies mixing. As cultural beings, we have nothing but syncretism in the church, and rightly so, since the gospel always gets inside culture. Parable of the yeast and the dough, parable of the mustard seed, parable of the wheat and the tares. We mix music, ceremony, language, art, symbols, vocabulary, fashion, ideologies, nationalism, and cultural metaphors constantly. So the question is this a step or the end product? And is this a kind of mixing that respects creator and culture, or the kind that contradicts or eliminates either a particular view of creator, what most people mean by syncretism, or culture, what the conservatives end up doing? True conversion, becoming transformed and over a lifetime conformed to the person of Jesus, is a gradual and erratic process of socio-cultural change or acculturation. It is not regulated or predictable, nor is it an evenly paced process of change and transformation, but quite the opposite. It is uneven, variable, messy, irregular, and fluctuating. It is an organic process of spiritual transformation as we engage the sacred ways of our Creator, bound by the limitations of our existence as finite human beings. As a syncretist, I have a core allegiance to Jesus as Creator that is enriched, further informed and inspired by traditional Lakota ceremonial ways and beliefs. I am able to hold the exclusive...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.